People need to live spiritual lives. All of us, I'm a person, and it's good to have access to the infinite consciousness that is available to all people, but through the five senses is delineated, keeping us trapped on a material plane.
We think reality is what we can apportion through the limited instruments of the senses, but reality is, of course, far beyond that. Spiritual data, we don't have the correct instruments to receive it, and we live primarily in the realm of the senses.
Reverse engineer your truth. It's all self-awareness and then putting yourself in a position to succeed.
I mix patience with ambition and hope that I get gratitude. Other times I hope that I get Spanish chicks with attitude.
No, it's not easy telling your truth.
What's up, everybody? Welcome to my new series of compilation videos. I'm really just going to be making compilations of videos, of inspirational videos, whether it's, just inspirational speeches from different persons or from a specific person, or I'm also going to be doing I'm going to be watching documentaries and picking 10 clips, the 10 most impactful clips in my the 10 most informing most impactful clips in my opinion, and I'm going to make a compilation of, you know, the top moments of each documentary that I watch. So that's another type of compilation that I'm going to be making. But yeah, these inspirational compilations, I don't know how I'm going to call this series yet. Probably just like revolutionary inspiration, something like that series. Something like that. Either way, this series, I'm going to be doing it on Monday and Wednesday, and then I'm going to be doing at least two or three vlogs a week, aside from these two compilation videos that I'm going to do Monday and Wednesday. And this is part of how I mentioned in my last vlog, I'm changing the cadence of how I do everything, so let's see how this works out. This changing the cadence includes everything, obviously. How I release videos, how I learn music production, how I do, you know, how I manifest my vision, you know, the general structure and how I manifest, how I go about manifesting my vision. And more on how that is, you know, evolving on the vlogs, you know, throughout the vlogs, that change will be reflected, and you know that transition is going to be reflected in the vlogs. But here's the first video, the first compilation of inspirational videos. It's going to be Russell Brand, Gary you something, I don't know how to pronounce that last name, and lastly, the last one is Carl Sagan. So I hope you enjoy it. If you do, please share it, and that's it. Much love, everybody. Peace out. Enjoy it. And pay attention, because these videos are very inspirational and have a lot of truth in them. Peace out. Much love, as always.
I think that one's reality is a result of your intention and your attention.
It's through spiritual practice that I've recognized that my own impermanence, my own irrelevance, the fact that I'm just a person shuffling through life, I ain't really no different now from when I was a little kid. And all I want really is I don't want that feeling in my stomach that people are being treated badly. I don't want a feeling that people are being exploited.
People need to live spiritual lives. All of us, I'm a person, and it's good to have access to the infinite consciousness that is available to all people, but through the five senses is delineated, keeping us trapped on a material plane.
We think reality is what we can apportion through the limited instruments of the senses, but reality is, of course, far beyond that. Spiritual data, we don't have the correct instruments to receive it, and we live primarily in the realm of the senses. Anything that we're describing through science, we're describing through the prism of the five limited senses. Our eyes can only see between infrared light and ultraviolet light. There's light bouncing around everywhere. Our ears can only hear a tiny decibel range, can't hear the noise of a dog whistle, can't hear any high-pitched frequency sounds. Isn't it likely then that there are other vibrations, frequencies, energies, consciousness moving through the universe?
Consciousness is an amorphous, an expanding entity. I think that we allow our consciousness to be prohibited by our senses, prescribed by our senses, living in the realm of these five apertures into our reality. But reality is limitless. Space is infinite. time eternal. Through yoga, one can temporarily break the bonds that chain us to the mundane, the mondial, that which is of the earth. And we can, temporarily at least, receive a taste of the infinite.
I don't want to get too cosmic about it, but we are just this sort of temporary blob of atoms, you know, endowed with consciousness for the merest moments in infinite space. Meditation and yoga, these are fundamental parts of my life. I think it's difficult these days with religion getting such a rough ride, the Pope resigning, bloody terrorism and nonsense. It's difficult to find an access to spirituality, but we are by our nature spiritual people. If we don't have access to spirituality, we suffer as individuals, society suffers. We need to recognise at some point that within ourselves there's an infinite capacity for connection with all things.
Well, I love the fact that you describe it as you have a daily access to unseen realms of power.
Daily access to unseen realms of power. Not just me, everyone has that. For me, what I've discovered is that transcendental meditation is useful to me, not because of a unique set of circumstances, not because of my formerly secret brilliance, no, but because I am a human being. And it is applicable to all human beings. And that, what's really good about that is literally everyone in this room is one.
What I say is that we're basically all right human beings. Whenever there's a disaster or an accident, people's impulse is to help one another.
So I'm thinking anyone that galvanizes people, brings people together and points us to the better aspects of our nature and help us to overcome our basic things like fear and desire, I think these people are worthy heroes. Rather than the heroes that are nominated today, heroes that are low vibrational frequency that make us concentrate on daft stuff.
So like they want you to be talking about Justin Bieber, they want you to be talking about twerking. They don't want you talking about fracking, they want you talking about twerking. And they want to get on with their job, shut your fucking mouths and watch this shit, you fucking morons. And I'm no, because I've been part of the charade. But, you know, I'm awake now. Look beyond the superficial. That's the problem with current affairs. You forget about what's important. You allow the agenda to be decided by superficial information. What am I saying? What am I talking about? Don't think about what I'm wearing. These things are redundant, superficial.
And I don't think that we should be continuing to propagate the idea that famous people are magical and special, because it makes people feel that their lives ain't no good. Mm. And I don't think we should be living in that kind of fearful paradigm.
It's that. I'm a vegetarian. I believe we're all equal. I ain't got the right to kill. I don't kill, like, say a fly comes in my house, I tolerate that little arsehole. Because I feel like he's a fly, he's just on his journey here through life.
When I'm meditating or praying, I say the infinite creative force that brings into being all phenomena and guides all life, I say, can you move through me?
And things that actually work, you sort of treat them, you sort of shirk them off as if, like, you know, as if you owe them money and you don't, well, no, I've got to avoid yoga and meditation. They've been portrayed quite brilliantly by the mainstream as sort of somehow luxury. But it isn't a luxury, or artificial, or superficial. It's absolutely integral, it's absolutely the most authentic thing, more real than any of us. If people are happy, they're happy, they don't need it. If there's not a problem, there's not a problem. But I think if people have some sort of yearning or dissatisfaction or some itchy irritability, then it might be because they're not looking in the right direction for a solution, and that they should look within, and that within them there is a limitless, infinite capacity for bliss through connection to higher things.
You cannot define yourself in reference to other external coordinates. You must define yourself internally with your relationship with a higher entity. Think of yourself as a manifestation of some higher thing, some higher frequency. This is the visible realization. And you know that because you can't see atoms, can you? And you certainly can't see the forces that hold atoms together. There, in the micro-quantum world, Richard, lie the answers to everything. We can't understand it with our logical, rational minds, but we feel it intuitively. Get yourself in alignment with that stuff and you beam like the sun.
The dead human ape has fulfilled its potential. The dead human ape has not evolved for the last 10,000 years. These are the achievements of the dead human ape. Now we must transform, become enlightened, right, so that we can access the next realm of consciousness necessary for evolution.
Right. So I think we elect to ignore the spiritual at our own, and it causes a deficit for ourselves and for our culture and for our planet. I think that we are too easy to identify ourselves as individuals. That idea is fortified daily through, as we said before, the stimulation of primal desires, that which anchor us to the self, and we ignore that we're here for such a short while, that we're all basically the same as one another, we're all connected to each other, and we have a collective responsibility to.
Look, God is not something that's about thinking you're better than someone or a reason to have a war with someone, it's that within us, beneath and beyond our identity as human beings, driven by fear and desire, defined by the realm of the senses and the material self, which is transitory, there is a divine self that is connected to all living things, that isn't part of an infinite source of creativity. You could probably describe that using quantum physics or science if you want. I choose to believe in God because I think what that is the recognition that there is divine beauty in all of us, and if we prioritize that over our own selfish material needs, then we will naturally create a culture more in harmony with our planet and we'll have a chance. I think it's one of the great sadnesses of more modern life, because of our disenfranchisement and disillusionment with religion, that we don't have access to these ideas. And yoga and meditation for me is a way in the secular world of accessing very, very beautiful principles that will perhaps make us happier at a time when people feel disillusioned with the economy, concerned about the ecology, worried with politicians, don't trust what they're being told on television.
We've got to let go of temporary, transient ideas like individualism. The nature of monotheistic faiths, these dead desert religions, is to encode us with the idea that individualism is more important than paganism, ideologies that integrally relate us to the earth, so that we know that we are integrally, indefatigably related to our environment, and we live in the service of our environment, because self is a temporal illusion.
I suppose the ultimate truth is oneness, that this is a temporary illusion, that we temporarily occupy these flesh puppets. We believe so much in our identities, we believe in our individualism, and I talk as a very sort of egotistical man. Look at my hair, look at these bracelets, look at these ridiculous boots. I'm a person who believes in the nature of my own individualism and my own identity. But on a deeper level, I recognise that all these things are transient, and what's important and what's defining are the things that we all share. Love, unity, togetherness. As long as we have cultural narratives that eschew these ideas, that suppress these ideas in favour of negative human traits, greed, selfishness, lust, as long as these ideas are promoted, we'll exist in opposition to one another and we'll be exploitable by corporations that prey upon these negative facets of humanity.
The line between good and evil runs not between cultures, religions or creeds, but through every human heart. So I recognise in myself the capacity for selfishness, for lustfulness, for egotism, and because I recognise these qualities in myself, I would prefer a culture that didn't celebrate, exacerbate, stimulate the most negative aspects of our species, inculcate them, reward them financially, till we get to a kind of a cultural hysteria where we're destroying the planet.
The reality is there is one planet, there is a certain amount of people on the planet, there are a certain amount of resources on the planet. None of them things are going to last forever, so we need systems in place that acknowledge the reality, not systems that benefit elites, but systems that acknowledge the reality. People need to have access to the resources. Can't lie to people so that people in power can continue to augment and grow their own power and satisfaction while normal people are exploited.
We need systems that get the resources to the people while respecting the planet. Any system that's detrimental to the planet or detrimental to the people because it helps one or two bods, fuck it off. We're allowed to do that, you know. We are creatures on a planet. We are mammals. Look at the faces of the people that we're being asked to vote for as leaders. Look at them. Look at them, feel it in your hearts. That ain't who's meant to be leading us.
Happiness cannot forever be sustained like some glistening bauble. It's a transitory thing, like a butterfly alighting on Snow White's finger in that bit of Snow White. So, I'm happy mostly. I'm happy mostly when I'm being nice to other people, then I'm happy. You know, when they analyse the semantics consistently through mythology and theology of words like love, God, they find that the common theme, John, is union. That we just want to be connected to something higher. That can be another person, that could be God, that could be a relationship with nature, it could even be a relationship with West Ham United. I think the important thing is to have this, the central tenet of your being, love, compassion and tolerance. Everyone knows that.
You know, like the realization that this is only a very temporary thing, that the only thing that matters to any of us is love, that everything, that underscoring everything is love. You know, if it's a biological anatomical human condition, the idea of acquisition and survival of the species, then that 2% that distinguishes us from the great ape, somewhere within that is that divine spark that philosophers have always espoused upon and written about, that somewhere within that's the truth that we're trying to head towards.
What it felt to me was like the dissolution of my idea of myself. I felt like separateness evaporated. I felt this tremendous sense of oneness. I find it, I'm quite an erratic thinker, quite an adrenalized person. And like, but what, through meditation, I felt this sort of beautiful serenity and a selfless connection. You know, my sort of tendency towards selfishness, I felt that kind of exposed as a superficial and pointless perspective to have. I felt a very relaxed sense of oneness. I felt like, I felt love.
Follow me on Twitter if you want to, at Rusty Rockets. But basically, carry on doing what you're doing, being happy in your hearts.
Well, first of all, I'm here to speak on behalf of the most oppressed, most abused, most murdered group of beings that has ever existed.
I mean, when was the last time a chicken or a cow attacked a human being? How about never? A pig, a turkey, never. We're the ones that attack them. Cows have harmed nobody. Chickens have harmed nobody. We are murdering innocent beings.
We send them to slaughterhouses. They know what's going on. They're aware. They're conscious. They smell death and fear and blood in the air. We cut them up into pieces.
The animals are not willing participants.
We're teaching them that it's okay to disregard animal life, that human life is more sacred than animals, when every creature on this planet values their life just like humans value their life.
We all suffer in the same way. We all feel pain in the same way. A knife in my throat is just as painful and harmful as a knife in a cow's throat, in a chicken's throat.
Because people don't realize how much they're harming animals in their daily lives.
Most people I know aren't evil people, but most people don't realize their daily choices support evil.
So if you put a knife in my hand when I was growing up, even though I ate meat, said, hey Gary, go kill that cow, Millie, you must be crazy. I'm sticking that knife in somebody else's throat. So we pay other people to do it. So I want to reach those people that are passively evil, that passively take part in this, and that's the masses.
So I'm just pointing this out to everybody, because people don't realize how much they're harming animals in their daily lives. So as I point out, the steak, the hamburger, the chicken sandwich that you're eating, the schnitzel, okay, these pieces of meat came off the bodies of living animals who didn't want to be murdered, who didn't want to suffer and die, who didn't want to be tormented.
It is the most profitable business on this planet since the beginning of time, animal slavery. Nothing comes close. Not cars, not gasoline, not oil, not computers. Nothing compares to the amount of money being made off the backs of animals, literally.
I want to show people what's going on, because if you watch the news, if you watch TV, the advertisements are happy cows. So I went to a slaughterhouse on my own to see what was going on.
I heard their screams. I smelled death in the air. One of the most disgusting things, to smell fear and death.
Why don't they show you slaughterhouses and say, hey, this is where your hamburger comes from. This is where your chicken nuggets come from. They intentionally lie to you. I don't lie. I intentionally tell you the truth, because I think if you saw what was going on in the slaughterhouse, no logical person could choose to continue to eat animal flesh.
It is sad that we can't talk to kids about the truth, about what's going on in the world.
Every second, just so you know, of every minute, of every hour, of every day, female animals are raped to impregnate them. Every second, animals are being killed.
In America today, 30 million innocent beings will be murdered for a sandwich.
Well, we're talking 12 million people were killed by the Nazis. In 1 year alone on this planet, 60 billion land animals, 90 billion marine animals are tortured, tormented, and killed in the world's most massive Holocaust. That's just in 1 year alone.
And when we teach children that the Jewish Holocaust was evil, but then we send animals to their death, to the slaughterhouses in the same extermination trucks that sent Jews to their death, we're committing a gross error.
Remember, I don't do things to be a politician. I don't say things that people want me to say. I speak the truth, and the truth is harsh. I know people don't want to hear that there's a Holocaust taking place that they're taking part in, but that's a fact.
I call human beings murderers of animals. That's what we do. That's the truth. The truth is harsh.
They must look at us like we are devils. We cut things off their bodies, their horns while they're fully conscious, off the cows. We cut the beaks off of hens. We rip the testicles out of baby pigs when they're born. We have treated our cousins in fur and feathers so horribly that beyond a doubt, if they ever formed an organized religion, the devil would be depicted in human form.
Put yourself in the animal's position. Imagine somebody raped you to impregnate you. You gave birth to this baby. This baby was stolen from you at birth. That baby was fattened up with corn and soy and wheat and oats. That baby was put on a concentration camp truck, sent to a slaughterhouse, hung upside down, fully conscious, in front of all of her own species, screaming, terrified, in fear, knife shoved into, you know, her throat, cut up into pieces. Where's the justification for this?
This is why vegans get so militant, because I don't want to be a two-legged devil to the animals or to anybody.
No injustice can live forever. Sadly, injustice can live for hundreds or even thousands of years, but no lie can last forever, and people are becoming aware.
Change is slow. It took 400 years to convince white people in America not to own blacks. You can see why this is taking so long.
I speak against speciesism in the same way Nelson Mandela spoke against racism. We live on a planet that murders animals, a speciesistic planet. Understand, like a racist who thinks that their race is better than another race. Speciesists think that the human species is superior to animals, and we have the right to harm and kill any species we choose.
Where do humans get off owning and controlling living beings? Do you know that if you took humans off this planet, the extinction of humans would benefit everything that exists? The animals, the forest, the air, the water, the mountains. If the bees disappear, everything falls apart. This is how special and valuable bees are to the world.
The issue is we just need to change the way we view animals. We have to realize humans aren't the only beings on this planet, and we're not more important than animals.
Because this is the first form of hatred humans are taught. Racism, sexism, anti-Semitism, heterosexism, these are branches of hatred. The root is speciesism. When you're a kid growing up, you're taught, hey, be nice to the dog, be nice to the cat. But that cow, that chicken, yeah, he doesn't count. Just kill them, screw them. Be nice to the horse. Be upset when somebody poaches a rhino. Be upset if somebody cuts the fins off of a shark. Hey, but that turkey, hey, kill him. It's Thanksgiving. It's a holiday. So the kid is confused growing up. So when we get down to talking about discrimination and why it's wrong, where it comes from, it all stems from that somebody looks and acts differently than you. If you taught a child growing up that, hey, just because that chicken looks differently than you do, that chicken has every right to live. That spider has every right to live, just like you do. How is that child going to grow up and look at a different person who's a different size, shape, and color? How is that kid going to look at that person in hatred, with violence? Speciesism, by eradicating that, we can bring peace to this planet.
You said my steak, I'm very big on language. That steak was never yours. Okay, that steak is a euphemism, by the way. That's cow flesh. That flesh belonged to another living being. So we always want to say leather when it's cow skin. Even the term bacon, what's bacon? You mean pig flesh?
75% of the animals on this planet are herbivores.
Of course.
But why do we try to justify human behavior based on lion behavior or shark behavior?
Notice you have clothes on. And I notice that you have a cell phone and you have a computer. It is unfair to pick one thing that lions do that you want to mimic when you don't want to mimic anything else they do.
You notice that convenient argument? We just want to do what the lions do when they eat antelope.
You put a two-year-old child in a crib with a bunny rabbit and an apple? Let me know when the child eats the bunny rabbit and plays with the apple. We are purely herbivorous. We have no carnivorous or omnivorous instincts whatsoever. It's an unfair comparison. You're not a lion. And just so you know, lions are carnivores. Humans are not. We are herbivores, 100%, up and down, physiologically. If your jaw moves from side to side in a grinding motion and you chew, you're 100% herbivore. If you were a meat eater like a lion, your jaw would only go like this, up and down, rip and swallow. If you sweat through your pores to cool yourself, you're herbivore.
See, the problem that I have is when people lie about why they harm animals, that animals don't think, that they can't feel, that they're not smart, that I need my protein, that we can do it in a humane way. See, we can't throw this word humane out there when we're talking about rape, torture, and murder. You can't put the word humane next to it. So if I go and meet a woman at a bar, I buy her some drinks, I bring her some flowers, I take her back and put on some soft music, some Teddy Pendergrass, and we dance and we look in each other's eyes, and I slip her a date rape drug and rape her, is that humane? Why not? She didn't feel a thing. See, because the act of rape is evil, okay? The act of murder is evil. You can't do it in a nice way. Okay, we have to stop thinking that there's a nice way. In fact, you know what the nice way to kill is? Not to kill.
That's a nice way.
I noticed that religious people love to worship things that we created in God's name. The Bible, the Quran, stars of David, the cross, but nobody worships anything that God created. It's the water, polluted, the air, polluted. The forest, cut it down. Anything that God made, we destroy. Anything that we made in God's name, we worship. So my condemnation isn't about God, it's about what religious people do. in God's name.
Over the years, as I've talked to tens of thousands of people, I've noticed that people who have been oppressed, Jews, Hispanics, women, blacks, they always respond better to this revolution that I'm involved in because they understand oppression. They've been through it. They know what it's like to be treated like nothing, like their lives don't matter.
People who have been harmed understand why it's wrong to harm somebody else.
So I want to eradicate the lies and get down to the issues at hand.
I'll show you hospitals full of people with heart disease, cancers, diabetes, osteoporosis, kidney problems, etc., all stemming from animal protein, the main cause of every major disease on this planet.
Now, here's what I love about the health benefits of veganism. When you're being altruistic, you should never expect anything in return.
Right.
When you're vegan, you get a lot of great things in return. Your health, you're good to the earth, because let's face it, the worst form of environmental destruction is animal agriculture.
That's right.
So there are some great benefits and kickbacks, but without a clear conscience, without mental health, we can't have physical health. So if you're going to focus on the physical health aspects and miss this aspect, you're still not right.
I think when you put violence in, you get violence out. You consume discrimination and death, you're going to, you know, exude the same horrible things.
Because some people may
say, what's wrong with somebody choosing to be compassionate, choosing to be good to the environment, so children don't have to starve to death around the world while we're feeding 50% of the world's crops to 60 billion land animals in the meat, dairy, and egg industries? And find peace on this planet by eradicating speciesism.
You can start, you know, giving compassion to the animal kingdom, to the insect kingdom. Then you start living peacefully with the planet and with each other. And peace begins at the dinner table.
Because we claim to be moral beings. We claim to know right from wrong. We claim to be compassionate. And as long as humans make these claims, I'm going to be in everyone's face and say, you can't do it halfway. The path to peace is through veganism.
So it's logical to want to be vegan, to want to reduce and eliminate pain and suffering.
Once I point it out to people, most people, sane people, logical people, make that next step.
It's thrilling to know that people are paying attention and making massive change.
And as we go back in time and look at all the other people that we adore now, collectively, we all agree, Gandhi and Dr. Martin Luther King and all these people, Rosa Parks and Cesar Chavez, do you know, they were not loved during their time. They were despised. They wanted to make change, massive change. It's only later on that a society looks back at revolutionary activists and says, oh, man, he was great. He was just trying to bring peace and justice.
This stuff has to stop.
From this distant vantage point, the Earth might not seem of any particular interest. But for us, it's different. Consider again that dot. That's here. That's home. That's us. On it, everyone you love, everyone you know, everyone you ever heard of, every human being who ever was, lived out their lives. The aggregate of our joy and suffering. Thousands of confident religions, ideologies, and economic doctrines. Every hunter and forager. Every hero and coward. Every creator and destroyer of civilization. Every king and peasant. Every young couple in love. Every mother and father. Hopeful child. Inventor and explorer. Every teacher of morals. Every corrupt politician. Every superstar. Every supreme leader. Every saint and sinner in the history of our species lived there, on a mote of dust, suspended in a sunbeam. The Earth is a very small stage in a vast cosmic arena. Think of the rivers of blood spilled by all those generals and emperors, so that in glory and triumph they could become the momentary masters of a fraction of a dot. Think of the endless cruelties visited by the inhabitants of one corner of this pixel on the scarcely distinguishable inhabitants of some other corner. How frequent their misunderstandings. How eager they are to kill one another. How fervent their hatreds. Our posturings, our imagined self-importance, the delusion that we have some privileged position in the universe, are challenged by this point of pale light. Our planet is a lonely speck in the great enveloping cosmic dark. In our obscurity, in all this vastness, there is no hint that help will come from elsewhere to save us from ourselves. The Earth is the only world known so far to harbor life. There is nowhere else, at least in the near future, to which our species could migrate. Visit? Yes. Settle? Not yet. Like it or not, for the moment, the Earth is where we make our stand. It has been said that astronomy is a humbling and character-building experience. There is perhaps no better demonstration of the folly of human conceits than this distant image of our tiny world. To me, it underscores our responsibility to deal more kindly with one another and to preserve and cherish the pale blue dot, the only home we've ever known.
Intuition, that's the rhythm that I'm grooving with. Tell me what's your energy. Show me what you're moving with. I ain't new to this. I'm stupid.
The only real revolution happens right inside of you. I said, what good is taking over when we know what you're gonna do? The only real revolution happens right inside of you.